Hey, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Don Herringa. I'm the Director of Education for the Eastern Division, and welcome to the Eastern Division's second webinar of the summer. Our first official one, but earlier in the summer, Brian Donovan ran a MA session for the snowboarders, which I heard was awesome. But anyway, today we are presenting the Alpine Ski Boot and the Body, presented by Dave Taylor. Dave has about 20 years of experience as a boot fitter. He's worked for ski shops in the East and for ski boot fitting in Vail. He's also worked with Nordica. His clients consist of national team members, education staff members, United States ski team members, and many of PSIA-AASI members. He presented an earlier version of this webinar live to the Eastern Division's Ed staff a couple years ago, and it was really outstanding. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dave. So everybody, welcome Dave Taylor.
All right. How's everybody? Well, I can't ask you how you're doing because you can't respond. All right. So let me put Don on mute here. Okay. So welcome to my house in New Jersey. This is going to be really interesting for me. I normally like to feed off the energy of all the people that are in front of me, field questions on the fly, and make this a fun, interactive clinic. So this is the first time that I'll be presenting this to more than 200 people. And I'm sitting here in my house with my two dogs and my six-year-old kind of talking to myself. So, how we're going to kind of do this is, I know people are going to want to ask questions. I do have someone that's kind of working the question field. And what we kind of want to make sure is, if there is a question that you feel is, or a comment that is pertinent to the 501 people that are going to be on this presentation, to please raise your hand. We will unmute you, and we'll field the question directly verbally. If you have any other kind of question, there is a tab there that you can put in a question and type it. Angelo is going to kind of field those questions. I'm going to read them and then come right out and bring those up. Just a little bit of background, and Don and I want to thank the Eastern Division for letting me do this. Talking about ski boots and anatomy and physiology and skiing is a quirky and crazy obsession of mine. I love it, and I cannot wait to keep talking about this stuff. So I've been a boot fitter. I started when I was 16 years old. I am the crazy age of 39 now. It's been, I built my first footbed when I was 16. It wasn't pretty. I've evolved since then. I've worked for some of the best boot fitters in the country, interacted, questions, answers. There's a lot of boot fitters out there in the East that I highly respect and look up to still these days. And I've had the opportunity to consult on some pretty serious boot fitting for some serious athletes. And it's been a fun road, so let's get started. So for the moment, I'm gonna kind of turn my webcam off and just kind of talk, and then we'll go from there. Okay, so kind of getting to like where this whole thing started. So, there's been a clinic that's been out called Stance and Alignment, great clinic that PSIA has offered for years. And if anybody that's on has had experience in boot fitting, sometimes there's a lot of dangerous information that goes into the wrong hands. Kind of like the little kid's game when you're talking to somebody's ear and whatever they call it, the phone chain or whatever, when you start with one person, by the time it gets back to you, it's a totally different philosophy or what you told that one customer, now the next guy comes around and it's a totally different deal. I came up to a couple of my friends that were on the national team who are also were clients of mine, And I said, hey, you know, one of the things that I continually run into is this kind of gray area or lack of knowledge of really what's going on inside the ski boot. You know, we all want to perform as boot fitters, and I will speak for all of them. We all have all of our customers' best interests at heart, and we want to do what's right for them. But without having the knowledge of what you do with a tool, things kind of get complicated, and maybe, you know, the pieces and the technical work that we're doing as boot fitters gets lost. And so this is where this all kind of stemmed from. So come on a journey with me here. We're going to get into anatomy. We're going to get into physiology. We're going to get into feeling some muscle movements. And then we're going to get into some boot engineering. And then we're going to talk about how we set up ski boots in kind of a vague but specific-ish kind of way. So here we go. So again, used to standing in front of a bunch of people doing this. So this is where that part where I stand up and I go, what is this? And I get in a lot of blank stares and people go, ah, it's a ski boot. Oh yeah, it's a ski boot. And well, it's a ski boot. What do we do with it? Well, we put it on our feet, especially if you're a beginner skier and you're coming out of a rental shop, man, you've got these things on your feet, you're trying to walk in them. They're these goofy shoes. They don't fit right. They're painful, you know, and it's just a totally counterintuitive, crazy thing that you're about to do. Well, we're going to touch on these things. It is a ski boot, yes. What do we do with it? Well, to sum it up, it's a power transmission device. It's a tool. It's not a piece of footwear. It's a tool. And we're going to go through a bunch of terms in these first group of slides. And we're going to talk about stance. We're going to talk about setup. We're going to talk about ski boots. We're going to talk about dorsiflexion, inversion, and eversion. These are the key takeaways that you have to have take away from this first group of slides. So stance, let's just go by the old Wikipedia definition here. The way in which someone stands, especially when deliberately adopted, as in baseball, golf, and other sports, skiing, it's a person's posture. So in skiing, it's unique because our stance can be dynamic. It's necessarily not a static thing. It's kind of like that initial stance, right? Like the shortstop is getting prepared for the ball to come, and he has a stance. That stance may be different than the first baseman, and it may be different than the catcher, and it may be different than the pitcher. Same comes from golf. You know, we look at the stance can be different in a short game or a putt as opposed to a driver. And so in skiing, it's the same thing. So stance is something that, you know, we take a static snapshot of it, especially from a boot fitter's perspective. We have that initial snapshot of how when someone's standing in a pair of ski boots. But depending on the amplitude, the terrain, and, you know, whether there's 30 feet of snow that you're skiing on or it's boilerplate, you know, mid-Atlantic conditions, you know, your stance can change. So this might be the last time you hear me say this word, alignment. So alignment, definition-wise, an arrangement in a straight line or correct or appropriate relative positions. So again, when I'm going to speak my opinion, I will certainly put out there first my opinion. So my opinion, when I think of alignment, I think of taking things and aligning them in a straight line. I don't feel as if that's the best way to describe how and what we do with ski boots. I think it takes it and gives us a little bit too much of an idea that we have to have straight legs or a certain position that's perfectly aligned in a straight line to describe what is good alignment. Again, this is my opinion, but I've got the floor, so I'm going to roll with this. Setup. Now, this is the term I love to talk about when doing ski boots. The assembly and arrangement of tools and apparatus required to perform a performance of an operation. The preparation and adjustment of machines for an assigned task. When I think of what my job is, I really am like a NASCAR or a race car technician. I am setting up the car for you to drive. I am taking all of your flexibilities, all of your inabilities, all of your, you know, your flat feet or your Tavis feet or your neutral feet or whatever it is, and I am working hard to so that you can maximize the amount of athletic performance on the ski boots, in the ski boots, as possible. No people are the same. No setup is the same between one person and the next, or even between twins. So setup is something that's very specific to you and to make you, to maximize your performance and your abilities to ski. So I like to call this stance and setup. Big space there, and then we've got ski boot. Now they start off with it's the footwear used in skiing to provide a way to attach the skier to the skis using a ski bind. The ski boot binding combination is used to effectively transmit controlled inputs from a skier's legs to the snow. And I like how they, and again, this is not my definition, this is the accepted definition on Wikipedia. I love how it's control inputs, and because it is, you know, the input that we're putting into the ski boot to get something out of the skis is something that is a skill. It's a controlled movement, and I do love that definition. But wrap a big bow around that, dress it up and put it under the tree. It's a power transmission device. We are applying forces to the ski boot, and the ski boot is then applying those forces to the ski, and the ski does something. And in between those two is the binding, and that kind of just holds everything together. All right, let me just see here for a second. How are we doing on questions there, Angelo?
Good, Dave. Keep going. I'm fielding some.
Okay. Perfect. Turn my video back on here for a second. Okay. All right. So we talked about ski boot. We talked about stance. We talked about setup. So let's talk about the foot. This is where we're going to start, and this is where we're going to go for a while. So the foot and the ankle are a complex system which consists of 28 bones, 33 joints, 112 ligaments, controlled by 13 eccentric and 21 intrinsic muscles. Now, just to be clear on a couple of things, intrinsic muscles are all the little muscles that are like in and around our physical foot. Okay, so we talk about intrinsic movements. So all these little like microscopic movements that we make to let's say do balance or to, I'm gonna use the terms here in a minute, evert or invert our foot. And there's these little movements that have to happen between all of that stuff. And all those little muscles that are inside there, those are our intrinsic muscles. They literally support the arch. They are literally the pieces that hold the structure, the bag of bones, kind of together to do a function, right? They're not like the ligaments that literally are the rubber bands that hold them together, but they hold it together for a purpose, to do something, to move that metatarsal just a little bit to be able to balance. This is where foot deterioration is, right? So this is where flat arches come from. This is where a lot of injuries in the foot, plantar fasciitis, is one that, you know, immediately comes to mind. The extrinsic muscles are the bad boys that help us perform and perform actions. So they're the anterior, so the muscles up front, the muscles in the back, and the muscles in the side, the lateral muscles. Those are the ones that do the inversion, eversion, dorsiflexion, and plantar flexion. Okay, I'm sorry, I'm gonna turn my video up because I'm sick of looking at myself. Okay, there we go. All right, so I'm sure there might be a question or two on that, but if there is one, Angela, stop me. So the foot is subdivided into the rear foot, the midfoot, and the forefoot. So we're going to get into this with some cool visuals so you can actually see this a little bit clearer, but it's just important that you see how it's divided into three sections. The function, it functions as a rigid structure for weight bearing. It can also function as a flexible structure to conform to uneven terrain. The foot and ankle provide various important functions, which includes supporting body weight, providing balance, shock absorption, and transferring ground reaction forces. Really like that last one there. So that kind of sums up, you know, if we wanted to define the foot the best we could, and even let's just say foot and ankle, that's how I would sum it up. You know, there is a lot going on there, and it does a lot, as we all know. So what is the ankle joint or the foot and ankle? What are the movements that it does? Well, medically, it does four things. It inverts, it everts, it dorsiflexes, and it plantar flexes. So I'm not going to put up written definitions of what these movements are, but this is it. So inverting is lifting your big toe up, lifting the inside of your foot, or kind of opening your arch up. Eversion is kind of closing your arch and opening your fifth metatarsal sides. It's pretty self-explanatory in the picture. Dorsiflexion is the closing of the ankle joint. So literally lifting the toes up on the axis of the heel staying in place, right? And then plantar flexion is when the foot comes back down, like pressing on the gas pedal in your car. So dorsiflexing is letting off the gas pedal, and plantar flexion is putting down on the gas pedal. There's not much more. There are some subtle movements that happen through the tarsus that we're gonna get into, but really this is what the ankle does. When we start to talk about adduction and abduction and putting the foot and moving it, that side to side movement, if you notice, if you're all sitting somewhere, if you can just take your hands and place them on your knees and have your feet flat, I mean, if you have shoes on, this might be a little bit more difficult, but through your ankle joint, keeping your pressure on your hands, pressured on your knees, pushing kind of your feet into the ground, try to abduct and adduct, which means move your foot side to side. When you do that, there's just the slightest bit of movement that happens. And you can kind of even look down at your feet and see that the middle of your foot, like right in front of where your lower, where your leg attaches, and you see the top of your foot, your instep, or the top of your arch, however you want to describe it, you can see that there's a little bit of movement going on there. But you lift your feet up and put your hands on a table, and you adduct and abduct your feet, you can move it a lot more because you've now brought the tibia and fibula into that movement. So now we've got the knee joint is now assisting in moving that. Then you kind of stand up and hang one leg out and twist that and adduct from your hip. And it's, holy smokes, the foot can abduct and adduct even more. So just want to make clear that the abduction and abduction it is something that happens within the foot, within the tarsus, that the midfoot section, but it's not doing a whole lot. You got to integrate the rest of the foot or the lower leg to be able to make that happen. Okay, so the body in respect to the ski boot. All right, so here's our bones that sit in the back. We've got the talus. Let me get my little pointer out here. Bam. Okay, so we got the talus, calcaneus, cuboid, lateral cuneiform, middle cuneiform, and the medial cuneiform. And these, all these little bones here, these are called metatarsals. Then we got metatarsal head and hallux. And the one cool thing is that if you notice, every toe except for your big one there, these all have three of them. And the big toe has only got two. So, and then these are what we could call in our terms, our ankle bones. So you got lateral and medial, which is the inside is medial. Outside is lateral, malleolus. Okay. So this is your three-dimensional wild spinning piece here. For our term, in our terms of what we talk about the ankle joint, we talk about the hind foot and the midfoot only. Okay, it's called the tarsus, is the technical medical term for that section of the foot. So it includes the cuboids. The cuboid and cuneiform, the navicular, talus, and calcaneus. This is where the action happens. This is where inversion and eversion really take hold, where they are initiated and things really happen. And this is where dorsiflexion happens. Oops. Go away. So there it is. There's the midfoot, the tarsus. Okay, the green ones there, there's your cuneiforms. The red part is the navicular. The light purple is your talus. That's an interesting joint because it's a mortise joint, which means that it connects on three sides. And then you have the cuboid, which is that bluish, like dark purple piece right there. So this is where the meat and potatoes are. I'm going to get a little technical here. You don't have to write any of this stuff down, this is the, so the first joint I'm going to talk about is the talocrural joint, okay? This is, as it, you know, we talked about, I said the talus, this is the talus joint, okay? This is where dorsiflexion happens. Range of motion of dorsiflexion, and I have to have two numbers up there because there's two medical studies that are leading on this that have talked about it. So it's either 0 to 16 degrees or 0 to 25. Okay, so you know, take that at 0 to 25 seems a little steep to me, but basically just saying that there's a massive range of motion difference on an average. Okay. Believe it or not, this changes under weight bearing. So we go from, you know, having a ton of dorsiflexion, like if you're dangling your ankle right now and you dorsiflex it, it moves a lot. You stand up and try to dorsiflex it, doesn't move so much. Something very much to consider when we talk about assessing feet and then what happens actually inside the ski boot. Okay, the subtalar joint. So that's the joint that sits between the light purple and the yellow piece there. That's your calcaneus is the yellow. Okay, so that is where eversion and inversion happens. Okay, so inversion, range of motion is 0 to 30 degrees to invert your foot. That's to roll that ankle to the outside, lifting the inside of your arch. Eversion, the range of motion is about 18 degrees. So that's kind of flattening your arch, pressing down. These are just some cool facts, okay? So when you're not weight-bearing and you dorsiflex your foot actually everts, I'm sorry, adducts and everts as you dorsiflex, unweighted. It wants to kind of go to the outside and put that big toe kind of side of your foot down to the ground. And then the talonavicular bone joint and the calcaneocuboid joint. Well, that's the joint that sits, and Angelo asked me to put this up, so hold on. Okay, so that's the joint that sits, if you look at the picture on your right, the red piece to the talus, so hence the name, talonavicular, and then the cuboid to the calcaneus, which again is that in that name. And that's where you kind of see this inversion, eversion, unlocking and locking to the joints. So when you invert your foot, it locks those together. When you evert your foot, those bones kind of spread apart. And that's where that, you know, your strength comes from in the eversion position. How are we doing, Angelo?
Couple questions on fit. I don't know if you want to fit with regard to comfort. I don't know if you want to wait till later.
Yeah, we can wait till later. I want to haul right through this. Okay, so here's our foot. Just want to talk about how we talked about how we break it up longitudinally wise, midfoot, or forefoot, midfoot, hindfoot. Well, and in your straight on view of the foot, when you're staring right at your toes, are looking down at your foot, it's composed of the first metatarsal and the medial cuneiform, which is the first green little block there as that thing rotates. That's the medial side. All right, we've got the middle, which is the second and third metatarsals, and intermediate and lateral cuneiforms, which are the second and third little orange or green block. And then we have the lateral side, which is our fourth and fifth metatarsals that connect directly to the cuboid. So when I'm talking about boot fitting and talking about building footbeds and things like that, forefoot, hindfoot, midfoot, medial, middle, and lateral sides of the foot. You've got to break it apart. They all function differently. Okay, lateral side of your foot is the majority of your weight bearing. The middle part of your foot is like intrinsic movements, and your first metatarsal, that baby right there, is big time in the propulsion world. And that's just another vantage point so you can see how that's split up. I don't know if you guys have ever talked to a bunch of people on a webinar, but it's kind of challenging because I feel like I'm either moving too fast or giving too much information. Okay, so just to revisit this before we get into the muscles, inversion, eversion, dorsiflexion. If anybody doesn't understand this or doesn't or has a serious question when it comes to this, raise your hand.
Dave.
Yes.
There are some pretty specific anatomical questions. Do you want to do those during this part or wait till later?
No, go ahead.
Okay. So let me see. I have one here about well, the question says, what should I be concerned with after having surgery on my peroneus longus tendon in my ankle?
Save that one for the end.
Okay.
That's a great question. And I've seen that ruptured in ski boots due to some issues with some fitting. Mm-hmm. You got to be really aware of how much the foot is loaded in the inversion position with a footbed or canting, or how much varus, which is the term we'll talk about, how much varus something has to load that. Yeah, great question. But let highlight that one if you can. Okay.
Yeah, did that. And I one about flexibility of ankles, and I know you're going to cover that later. So quite a few people have asked about that, like I have flexible ankles or I have not flexible ankles. So I know that's coming up in a bit.
Yeah, I'm going to give everybody an opportunity. So like I have an email that I'm going to send out to everybody that, you know, if you have further questions, you can ask me. Or, I mean, if you have a boot fitter that you already go to, I mean, this is a great maybe inspiration to ask those questions to your local, boot fit. So, I mean, that's another, another good idea too. We'll keep rolling here. Okay, so inversion, eversion, dorsiflexion, plantar flexion. So we should all at this point kind of understand how these movements are kind of done through the midfoot and through the subtalar and the talus joint. Okay. Love all these new graphics I have. Okay, so tibialis anterior. All right, so the best thing to do is we're going to hopefully get interactive here. So I want everybody to just stay seated. And if I'm going to, just to show that I'm actually doing this, I'll turn my video on, which I don't know how to do right now. Okay, sorry. All right. So I want you to take your hands and put them right below your, what would be like the bottom, like right below your patella, because if you're seated. And in a simple movement, we talked about inversion and eversion. What I want you to do is first, I just want you to dorsiflex your feet while keeping your heel on the ground, just lift all of your metatarsal heads off the ground. And you should feel tension. You should feel a muscle press against your fingers. And if you lower it, they relax, and you lift up and they tighten. Okay. Now I want you to invert your foot and just roll the entire foot over like this. Okay. But keeping your foot on the ground. So you're going to just kind of roll to the outside. And I think what you'll feel is some tension to the outside of your, like kind of towards the knuckles of your hands if you wrapped around your knees like this. And then this time I want you to try to invert your foot by pressing down on your little toe. And what you should feel is that same muscle that's highlighted here and spinning around firing, but not as intensely as it did when you are dorsiflexing. So the tibialis anterior muscle, its primary, now there's some notes there about where it is, and you know, for the sake of time, we're going to keep moving about where it is, because I'm hoping that you can feel it. Its primary job is to dorsiflex and to invert your foot, okay? So it does the action of moving forward and flexing the ski boot, and it rolls the foot or tips the boot on the little toe side, okay? It works your inside half. This is a critical movement. It's a learned movement. And one of the things I'm going to have you do now, and I'm going to do it with you, is to stand up and do the same thing. I want you, now that where you've located that muscle, just add tension to the muscle. So you're just going to, like you're flexing your bicep, I want you to flex that same muscle that you just felt. And feel what your body does. Okay? And then do it one more time and just let your body go with it. Cool. So you thought you were going to be able to sit down the whole time. So what that is when you're firing that muscle, it's actually closing your ankle joint. It's dorsiflexing. Now, it's not dorsiflexing like this when you're sitting there and you're just lifting your forefoot up when your foot's dangling. But what it does is it's actively flexing forward using specific muscle movements to actually close the ski boot. Here's a little closer look at it. Okay, so we're back to the seated position, and we're gonna take our hands again, and we're gonna put them right where they were, and we're gonna move down to right where, like if you had a pair of crew socks, black toe socks, where kind of, I'd say about 3 inches, 4 inches above your foot, where the connection of the foot and the lower leg is. Now this time, I want you to dorsiflex. Feel what's going on right around where the palms of your hands are if they're wrapped around your legs. And then this time I want you, now I want you to evert your foot, which means I want you to push down and kind of collapse your arch with the focus on pressing down on your big toe. Now I hope that, and again, this is hard because I can't see any of you and look at the blank stares, but hopefully you felt that. It almost feels like there's a little indention that gets created as you make that everting movement. So this is another muscle that performs two actions. It dorsiflexes and it everts our foot. Okay? So one of the important things when understanding these two muscles, the anterior tibialis and the peroneus tertius, or tibialis anterior, I call it the AT and PT. For those of you that have been in my clinics before, it's like everybody hears me yell this stuff. But what it does is that it's a blended movement through one single muscle, right? There are other inverters and there are other everters. But those everters or inverters are directly correlated to plantar flexion, which is something a ski boot really doesn't allow us to do. We open our ankle joint. That's what everybody said. Oh, well, I open my ankle joint. Yes, you do. But does your ankle ever go beyond neutral? No. So it goes from that neutral position to a dorsiflex position, back to a neutral position. It doesn't open all the way up to a plantar flex position, a propulsion position. So, so there we have our, this is a blended movement in that dorsiflexion and big toe edging, downhill ski edge. How are we doing, Angelo? I just got to keep motoring along here.
Good. Yeah. Most of the questions are very, very specific to people's injuries or surgeries and whatnot. So keep rolling. I'm giving them advice to send those types of questions to your email when you put it.
Yep. So there's a close for one. Okay. So we're going to stay really quickly. We're going to fire right through this one. Extensor digitorum longus. All right. And then one of the important things, yes, dorsiflexion, yes, eversion. But one of the biggest things is it's windlast, right? The lifting of the toes. It lifts our toes up. Our body, unless you're the most, a very skilled person that can go beyond subconscious movements, like breathing, we lift our toes during heel strike in gait. In gait meaning walking or running. So we lift our toes to strike our heel down. And if you don't believe me, I want you to stand up, bend your knees a little bit, and lift your toes. And if you're feeling what I'm feeling all the pressure go from the front of my foot to the back. And the reason being is because immediately the posterior tibialis tendon and other tendons and muscles that are in our the posterior part of our body, when these extensor muscles open up and they lock our foot up, immediately those come into play. Because they are preparing for slamming down into midfoot and then propelling us into the next movement. So whenever you tell someone to lift your toes, to flex the ski boot, you're basically, what you're doing to the foot is you're taking this relaxed piece, right? And you're doing this, or even better, this, and then asking someone to grab something, right? So it takes and throws the entire foot into like a hemorrhage. And then we're asking to perform movements, which is kind of where we get some of these. Sometimes you will get a segmented movement pattern. The dorsiflexion through toes closing and then angulation, as opposed to two movements all blended at once. And then this is the big toe one. Again, these assist in initiating dorsiflexion. you can't really dorsiflex without this muscle actually doing something. But to primarily focus on lifting the big toe and not just letting it do its thing through the movement of dorsiflexion is not recommended. No hands up yet?
Yeah,
their voice?
Just a moment for housekeeping. I'm getting a lot of messages that people can see you, but not your slides. So FYI, your video is still on. But if you're having trouble seeing the slides that Dave is referring to, look for a white horizontal bar across your screen and slide it up, and that will minimize Dave and maximize his slides.
Is that better?
Yeah, now you're off the screen and the whole screen is your slide.
You guys don't get to look at me talk? Terrible. Okay. Again, we've only got a certain amount of time, so I got to keep moving. So here we are with, so what does this all mean? You know, and why am I here, a boot fitter, talking about anatomy? Because a lot of times when I'm working with people in the shop, I like to explain things so you have a better knowledge. I also like to explain what I'm doing as I'm doing it, just because I feel like that's, you know, what you deserve when you're in my shop. But the biggest thing is that through proper ski movements, does setup and all of these things actually make the boot function, right? So I'm not just handing you a screwdriver to put a nail in, okay? So I want to give you the tools, not just in terms of the boot fit, but also to have that knowledge of how these things are actually engineered and how they're designed. So when we talk about these blended movements, we talk about planes of motion. And this should at least, now there's one that says horizontal plane of motion. So just, there's a typo, just don't freak out. So we start with the sagittal plane, right? That's where the ankle and lower leg. So that's where the talus joint is going to be able to dorsiflex fore and aft. That's where we move through that plane. Okay. We have the frontal plane, which is, you know, through our foot, those are initiated in reference to the ski boot. That's our edging. That's the eversion and inversion. That's where those are initiated, and then up the joint chain angulation increases. Then we have the transverse plane, which is where the ankle does some of the abduction and adduction initiations, and the pelvis does rotation and counter rotation. Okay, it says horizontal plane, but we're sticking with the transverse plane here. Okay, so these are all happening at once. When we initiate movements appropriately with the correct muscle group, everything's rolling at the same time. Okay, we use the anterior tibialis on our inside half to get that inside ski up on edge and dorsiflex at the same time, and use the peroneus tertius to flex the ski boot forward and evert our foot at the same time. We are blending frontal plane and sagittal plane movements all together in one shot. So it's a beautiful thing. And then other parts take over as we deal with ankle, the adduction and abduction through the ankle joint and subtalar joint. Those are initiated, and through the rest of the turn, the feet rotate. Okay. And so what all this is comes down to is understanding those muscles, understanding the functions of the ankle joint, we get that motion moving, okay? So when we're getting footbeds made and we're getting other parts of boot fitting done, we understand the application because, oh, okay, we're doing this to my boot for my fore and aft sagittal plane movement, and I do that through dorsiflexion, or I'm struggling with dorsiflexion, or whatever, however the conversation goes. A lot of times this is where I get a lot of questions, especially from ed staff members and national team members and this, that, and the other, because there's a lot of different opinions, but this is the objective pieces that actually what they do in what plane of motion. But the key takeaway is that it all happens at once. So I'm going to run through one video of what the planes of motion look like. But I just want you guys to focus on, this is a really cool vantage point of Michaela Schifrin training slalom. talking about blending the movements, okay? How nothing is segmented. She's not flexing and then edging and then doing this. It's all blended together through lower leg muscle movements to initiate what's going on. So that's a cool video. You really get to see the dorsiflexion. It's hard to do a dorsiflexion with your wrist backwards, but the dorsiflexion and the inversion and eversion, that all blending all together, right? And that's what that's all about. And that's what's understanding the muscles in our lower leg that are doing this. And hopefully when you take this on the hill or maybe take it on the hill with me or one of the other trainers, that you'll really start to feel that. That how that really works and how smooth it is. Okay, everybody should see a bunch of old ski boots on their screen. Okay, so that's it for anatomy. We're gonna move on to ski boots, which is probably what you thought I was gonna talk about. So this is just an example I just wanted to look at. You know, we really haven't come that far, okay? This is, you know, some of these are pretty unique. You know, the K2 boot, the Hansen boot, you know, the SX92, I mean, this is all before my time. I mean, I remember TNT boots blowing up on the ski trails because the plastic synthesized. That's about as much as I remember. But we haven't come all that far, right? I mean, there's the TNT. There's the new Mach. They're both orange. They both have four buckles. But from my point of view, I look at this and I go, whoa. Look at the hinge point of the boot. Look at where the rivet is on the side compared to where it is on the TNT. Look at how anatomically shaped the boot is, the shell itself, okay? How much lower profile it is, although I think the TNT buckles look way radder. This is two awesome ski boots, two very revolutionary ski boots. But really what I want you to take home from these next couple slides as I talk about ski boots and ski boot manufacturing and whatnot, is really looking at how different some of the models are compared to other brands, right? So I gotta throw this in there just because I always have this question, or somebody in my clinic's always got a pair. There's nothing wrong with three-piece shells, they're just different. So we call them three-piece shells or cabrios because they have a cuff, a tongue and a shell or a clog, and then a regular old ski boot that we know of that's been around since the dawn of time has a cuff and a shell and a claw or a clog. Okay, functionality wise, I've got lots of opinions on it, but you guys probably don't want my opinion. So looking at the ski boot, we've got a bunch of parts that most of you should know. We've got power strap, tongue, liner, cuff. You call it the shoe, the clog, the lower. Some people call it, I mean, I've heard it called the boot and the cuff. So it's, you know, also called boot. I prefer clog as being as my favorite way to term that I use. This little nugget over here, right there, that rivet that holds into the side of the boot, that's called the cuff alignment. Not to be mistaken for canting. Cuff alignment, cuff adjustment, however you want to call it. And then the big one is the rail. That's something that, you know, sometimes doesn't get discussed very often when it comes to ski boot manufacturing. But that rail is not uniform in its positioning with ski boot manufacturers. So when we talk about the rail, we talk about this piece. Okay, now how the rail sits in relationship to the foot of the ski boot determines what it feels like to edge it. So imagine this as an ice skate blade. If it's way over here, the boot's gonna wanna do this. If it's way over here, the boot's gonna wanna do that, okay? So there's there's no extremes when it comes to this, but it's certainly something to take into account. When I try ski boots on, there are boots that I put on, like this is my boot. I put this boot on and it feels really good. And I take another manufacturer and I feel totally bow-legged. The first thing I do is I take the boot off and I flip it and I look at the bottom of it. Is that rail moved all the way over to the inside, like my big toe side? And then what typically it is, and that's what makes me feel like my legs are getting pulled apart. Hopefully somebody asks a question about that, but questions that I've been asked in the past about that, is it uniform amongst brands? No. Is it uniform amongst models? No. Typically, you know, the rails move to the medial side, more on high performance race boots, AT, all-terrain boots, all mountain boots, that rails kind of slid to the middle. I have my whole life been a skier that needs the rail more towards the middle. It needs to be more, I need to see kind of like this head boot is. I got to get the right angle so you can see it correctly. But I like to have a lot more of this showing. That tends to work for me way better. I feel way more balanced. I'm sure there's, you know, there might be a boot fitter that's sitting in here that has a better explanation of what, you know, what that works for whom. And if they actually sell boots determined by the rail, I try to. And I try to try people in boots that where the rail is actually in a different position to see what the canting is or what the lateral alignment, lateral setup would require. So this is just a shot right down ski boots. You know, the thing you want to take away from this picture is, you know, the difference in the rivet placements. Okay, the difference in the shapes, right? I mean, look at the cut here in this Atomic one compared to how flat this Technica is, and how far that cuff pushes out. And then look at how straight up and down the Lang is, and how this positive stance a little bit in the Nordica in the Technica. You know, where the rivets are placed in the ski boot, you know, how far down and back this is. You know, really what that comes down to is goes back to that dorsiflexion inversion positioning. You know, the boot wants to go in a certain direction. Modern boots aren't designed to be flexed directly forward. They're meant to be flexed in a proximal position, which means kind of at a 45 degree angle. They're built to be stronger on the medial side. The plastic's thicker. There's no buckles and overlaps on the medial side. They're meant to be stand on when that comes to that big toe side. And then the uphill side, your uphill leg, you know, there's the buckles and all that stuff that shear, which creates a weakness. So it wants to flex this way. Not this way. And if you want to test that theory, put your boots on and flex it forward using your anterior tibialis tendon, not your knee driving down to the bottom of down to your toes. And then flex it proximally. You know, invert the boot, tip the boot, edge the boot on a little toe side and flex at the same time. I think you'll find that the boot bends a lot easier. Within the boots, we deal with a few angles. Forward lean, ramp angle are the primary ones that I want to discuss today. There are others. And then on the binding, we deal with delta angle. This is something that we don't really have to discuss as much as we used to, just because the industry has taken a point to try to create zero delta. It used to be 3, 4, 5 millimeters of difference between the heel higher than the toe. And creating a higher, you know, more forward lean and creating, you know, tipping a skier more forward. Now it's better. It's better. I'm not going to say it's perfect, but it's better. But sometimes when you're in a shop and you feel great and then you snap into your skis and you feel like your nose is hanging out over your toes, you know, you may want to look at take a micrometer out or go back to your boot fitter and say, hey, you know, could you measure the delta angle of my, and it may be like, oh, there we go. That's the problem. So just kind of discussing what I pointed out here, you know, the cuff of the boot is not a circle. Okay. It's an oval. The peak of the oval is actually here. All right. And some boot manufacturers, it's great. It's more exaggerated than others. You know, there's a weak point here because that's where the overlap is and where the buckles are. So that's where most of the shearing happens on the plastic. You know, that's the inside of the shoe or the clog of the boot. This side of the boot is actually, typically in a high-end boot is stiffer, thicker plastic. It's more rigid. The boot has a directional flex. It has a directional purpose. So this is your anterior tibialis and your peroneus tertius inside of my ski boot. That's not my leg, though. These were illustrated by a doctor who sat in my clinic and drew these for me as a orthopedic surgeon. Oh, geez, what just happened? Oh yeah, so that's boots. Anything, Angelo, that we need to?
Yeah, quite a few questions about the rail. Ranging from what we talked about earlier, a lot of people weren't familiar with it as part of the boot, and then some there's a question about what Fisher was doing with their rail, and then some questions that I know you're gonna touch on coming up in a minute with, like, how being bow-legged impacts where you would want the rail, etc.
Okay, so I want to touch on the Fisher. So Fisher does an abducted, well, did, still some of their boots, an abducted stance. So when I used to work for Nordica, we had a boot called the Aggressor. If anybody here has the, oh, yeah moment. So what Nordica did is they put the point here and rotated the foot in an abducted stance from this being the point where the abduction ended. So it was like the line went like this. Not like that, right? But Fisher did an abducted stance by creating the radius or the axis where the foot moved was here. So it actually tipped the heel and the toe all together, as opposed to Nordica kept the heel here and then moved the toe up. So, so the idea behind that was that, you know, we stand in an abducted position. I mean, most people do. And that was going to put the, and even if you looked at a medical journal about the subtalar joint, the talus, it has an abduction to it. So when we stand and we look down at our feet and we say, okay, well, my feet are straight. All right. The outside of your foot looks like the side of a pizza, and the inside of your foot looks like a straight line. So I would consider that, you know, that's would be abducted from nothing. So all ski boots have some form of abduction, right? But Fisher took it to a different level. Now, from what I understand, it's backed off a bit. I remember skiing in the initial boot, and it was like, my feet felt like they were going, like, my skis were pointing straight, but my feet felt like they were like this. And the ski boot performed great. I mean, I still believe that there's not a bad ski boot in the world. Even Apex boots have a purpose, and they're great for that purpose. But the one part that no one really touched on was during that time is that all boots have some form of abduction in them. It just depends on how much. And like I said, Fisher kind of took that to an extreme. And I think they found great success with it for a certain clientele. I know that I've heard that they've backed it off on a lot of their boots, but in some of their World Cup racers love it. So, you know, I'm not going to give you a negative opinion on it, but yes, that's what it is. And what was the question on the rail?
How being bow-legged impacts what, where you might want the rail placed on the boot?
Yeah. So this is a really cool question. And, you know, the impact for me, like, and this is something that you want to maybe work with your boot fitter is to take, you know, if you're bow-legged, take that boot and flip it over and look at it and see if how much of the, you know, the big toe side is hanging out there. Okay. Compared to the little toe side. I mean, this is really hard to look at because this is a 92 lasted boot, but you can see that there's still a fair amount hanging out. Compare it and find a boot on the wall that still fits in your fit zone. You know, if you're a 98 last, 102 last, and figure out if, okay, this one goes this far out. Throw your footbeds in it. Stand up on the boot bench with your boot fitter and be like, hey, drop a plumb bob on me and see what happens. It may make a huge difference. Or it may make a minimal difference. So, you know, I can't give you an objective, like, you know, I have evidence. I have a ton of evidence in the opposite direction where a customer came into me and was like, I've got, I love the ski boots that you sold me, but I want to try Atomic because Michaela is the best skier in the world and I want to be on Atomic. So we took their boot, you know, we take the footbeds, we took, you know, adjust the ramp angle, get the cup all set, slam the liner in there, we stand them up, and it's like their knee is over here and their foot's over here. You know what I mean? And it's just like, whoa, what just happened? You know, and then you go through the whole process of checking that probably, oh, I need to grind this or punch that, and then go through that process and it's just back to the same place. So, you know, I've seen it with my own eyes in the opposite direction where someone's neutral and gets thrown completely out of whack because of the rail placement or the cuff offset of the ski boot. So I hope that answers your question. I know I didn't answer your question, but my recommendation is to work with the boot fitter that you work with or go to a reputable boot fitter that you know of, ask your friends who they go to, and go from there.
Can you say something about pronation and rails also quickly, probably along the same lines?
Yeah. So that over pronation and ski boots I could do a whole hour long talk on that. Okay. So, but pronation and abduction and the rail placement are all kind of within the same thing, right? So when the foot is overly everted, it's kind of abducted. So you tend to fight the rail a little bit if it's too heavily on the big toe side. If that makes sense, you have opposing forces, right? The boot wants to pull you out, your feet and everything are collapsing to the inside and it just kind of binds everybody up. I hope that answers that question. But I mean, overpronated feet inside of any ski boot is a whole nother conversation. And I'm willing to have whoever asked that question, I would love to have that conversation. Okay, so we're getting into how we set this thing up and then we'll be wrapped up here. So, you know, terms we use when it comes to ski boots and setup. Okay, so we can fire right through these. Last, length, instep, flex, geometry, height, and rail. So we just spent a bunch of time talking about rail. Last, the volume of the ski boot. It's totally an incorrect term when it comes to ski boots because a last is actually like the inside plug or the wooden last of a shoe that we make leather shoes around. But in terms of what the ski boot has adopted it as is, it's the width, the millimeter width. Just like if you go to buy, I mean, I'm a 12 B shoe. So B would be my last, I guess, in terms of ski boots. So it ranges from 92 to 106 at the current moment. Length is the centimeter of the stance area of a ski boot. That's what Mondo size is. It's the length of the ski boot in centimeters. Your appropriate size should be 1 to 2 centimeters. No more than 2 in a high performance area. You can go to 2.5 and 3 if you want to just buckle your boots tighter and replace them every year. That's fine too. I'm not going to argue with you about that. But 1 to 2 centimeters in a shell fit, which I'll explain what that is. Instep, we have to measure the instep height of your foot because ski boots are rigid structures. So if we put you in a ski, if you have a really high instep, and can you guys still see me? I can't see my video. I don't know where it went. But hopefully, if you have a really high instep and a really short foot, if I put you in a boot that matches your centimeter length, it's going to crush the top of your foot. And I'm sure there's plenty of people out here that don't buckle the top of their boot, or their feet are always numb and tingly or cold or whatever. Typically, that's from too much pressure over the instep. Flex. All I have to talk about this is that flex is not a number that's uniform. It's not something that crosses brands. It doesn't even cross boots within a brand. It's a number that places the boots in a catalog by their performance level in each model and relative only to that model. So a length, you know, this head R2, RD is, I don't even know. I think they say it's 130 with one rivet or 140 with one rivet. I don't even know. But anyway, so that flex is only comparable to the R3. It is not comparable to the Raptor RS130 or the 140. A Lang RS130 is not comparable to an XT130. They don't flex the same. But out of the XT series, it is the 130 is the stiffest of those models. So hopefully that makes you feel great about flex, because that's really what it is. So geometry, forward lean ranges from 10 to 16 degrees. There may be some out there that are 18 degrees still. Full tilt, you know, they go that far. Ramp angle, you know, ranges around between 4 and 6 degrees. Some go up to 8. And then cuff offset is kind of how the cuff is rotated or where those rivets are placed in comparison to the shoe. That actually has a degree measurement by some brands. The height, you know, this is a big concern for someone short lower leg in a tall boot. Luckily, this isn't something we need to address as much because they make low cuff boots now. And then the rail we talked about. So this is the last chart. So this is how we measure last. So 26.5, which is the main line here, that's the benchmark of where brands measure and advertise last. So as you go down a size, it typically decreases 2 millimeters per size. So if I measure with a micrometer, I measure a 28.5 by 96. So even in the narrow recreational boots, I am almost half a centimeter too narrow for the highest end recreational boot. So this is in that handout that you can download. It's just good to know, when you know kind of your social security number of fit in the ski boot world, which is your sole length, your size, your last, and your flex. So this is kind of where they measure last. You can see from the first metatarsal to the fifth, but not all brands measure last in the same place. So that's something to consider, that even kind of throws that whole, it's just like flex. Last is not a uniform measurement. And then measuring instep, this is just a graphic that shows you how a higher instep would look, where we would have to adjust to the height of the foot over the length. So this just you know, reinforces what forward lean is, how we measure it, what ramp angle is. How are we doing on time? I can't move this thing.
About okay. 5:12.
Yep, hammering right through it. Okay, good. Are people losing interest? Yeah, a little bit. So what does it take? A day in the life of a boot fit? My number one advice is don't listen to your friends. There's an asterisk there, like listen to your friends, but don't listen to your friends. If they tell you that you should be in a Lang boot because they're in a Lang boot, that's the best boot ever, in one ear, out the next. Go into your reputable boot shop and listen to your boot fitter. Try on boots. So walk into a store, select a reputable boot shop, look at the inventory. Most shops will carry one boot in each fit size, so 198 last and 130, 198 and 120, whatever. But that doesn't mean that they're bad shops. Some shops don't have boots at all. There are plenty of good boot fitters that don't even sell boots. So we measure the foot, we measure the width, which is the last, the height, which is the instep, and we measure your length. We assess the foot in a talus neutral position. How much does it dorsiflex? How much ankle mobility does it have? How much does it pronate and supinate? When they stand up on the boot bench in bare feet, bend their knees, look at how the foot adjusts to the travel in, through dorsiflexion movements. You know, if they have footbeds already made, they're good enough, we just throw them right on there and go from there. You know, we select the, then after we have that assessment, we select the first shell. We do a shell test, which is that either in your bare feet, if you're, you know, a hardcore skier that wants the most tightest toes, or with the sock that you appropriately wear. You don't jam your toe up to the front of the shell. So you take the liner out, put your foot in the shell. You don't jam your toe up into the end. You just put it where you would be comfortable with it. Just, you know, grazing or whatever. And then look, you know, the technician or your friend or someone that's with you or whatever looks behind there. You know, no more than 2 centimeters. That's just kind of the running, you know, 1 centimeter for a high performance, you know, full contact fit, 2 centimeters for a little bit more comfortable. Try on 2 models at least. Identify your fits, identify how you stand in the boot, what your stance is, your fit zones. Put the boots on and put them through the paces. Walk around, edge, flexing the boot. Work the ankle, do inversion, eversion. The boot should be snug and generate mild numbness while you're in the shop. It takes 10 to 20 days for a ski boot to break in, so please keep that in mind. Do you feel balanced? Is your weight distributed through the midfoot? Okay, that tarsus section that we saw, the graphic of that rotating knuckles and joints. That's where weight needs to start, right through the midfoot. Okay, so not the calcaneus, but that right in front of where your lower leg connects to your top of your foot, okay? That way you can move, you can prance like a tiger when you're skiing, okay? Just as a recommendation, do not put a boot on in the shop and slam it forward and do like the jumpity jump one-legged flex test. If that's how you ski, like I'll let you go first. So flexing the boot. How to find the appropriate flex? Use the muscles that I talked about, the AT and the PT, to actually dorsiflex and invert, tip the boot. You know, flex that boot in the proximal direction. Use it as a, you know, make it a point to have a focused movement when flexing the ski boot, a real ski movement. In a ski shop, this should be easy to do. If it is difficult and you're breaking a sweat, the boot is too stiff. So from this point, this is where the boot fitter takes over, right? So all that this past slide over here, I am a total tour guide. That's it. Okay. I'm giving you all the sights and sounds. We get here. This is where things kind of change. So this is where a boot fitter takes over. We adjust angles. We need to add ramp angle for a limitation in dorsiflexion. We need to take it away for someone that has too much dorsiflexion. Are there fit issues? This is where I create the setup specific to your needs, not with the guy in front of me or in front of you that came off the bench. footbeds, canting, and other adjustments to be done at this time. Shell modifications, where we punch and grind. Taking care of bunions, you know, the six-toe bumps, instep bumps, arthritic joints, and it goes on and on and on and on and on of all these different things. I mean, this is where we deal with, you know, I had a guy that had his foot blown to pieces in Vietnam, and literally one foot didn't move, and it was three quarters of a size or a full size smaller, and his other foot was fine. You know, this is where we start to deal with the fitting of the boot. So sit back, speak, listen, and provide effective feedback. So if you have a question, ask. I am not a feeler is not the right answer to a boot technician. You know, we're trying to extract information because, you know, we don't have all the answers. We can't feel inside your feet. So it's best that, you know, you do that, providing some feeling and what it feels like. You feel balanced, you know. Guided discovery is one of the terms that I love you guys, that I love that PSIA uses. So then we talk about footbeds. You know, why do we get a footbed? Well, this is what creates ramp angle. This is a zipper board. That thing's as flat as a pancake. Okay, when we talk about the intrinsic movements of your foot, right? I got ahead of myself. So we got the boot board. Then we have this thing. This is the boot. It's built around a somewhat talus neutral foot. So the complicated part with that is so if you got an overly pronated foot, you're standing on a flat boot board inside the liner with whatever comes with the boot. We got all kinds of displaced positioning of the foot. All right. So we got to build a footbed to get in there and fix this. Also, in a performance aspect, the intrinsic movements, we broke the foot up into the first metatarsal, second and third and fourth and fifth. So if all those intrinsic movement muscles or intrinsic muscles are always busy keeping your foot in a position without any kind of support, the effective balance and movement patterns of doing eversion, inversion, and dorsiflexion are thrown right out the window. So it serves a purpose beyond being just a stabilizer or preventing your feet from rolling side to side too much. What we do with a footbed is we try to neutralize the foot in a position where it can interact with the ski boot and effectively allow you to produce movements. So it's all about, that's when we talk about setup, that's what we're doing with a footbed. The types of footbeds, well, there's custom and there's all kinds of casting methods. I'm sure that you've heard from one boot fitter to the next, or to the next, to the next, that somebody does super feet, somebody does Instaprint, somebody does conformable. You know what? I have no qualms about any of them. I don't think any of them are bad. And again, that's my opinion. So everybody has an opinion. But I have never had any issues making any of these footbeds. They all have their place. Sometimes they're a little bit more complicated to work with certain types of feet. But I mean, I try to do as many different versions as possible. I have the ability to do weighted, semi-weighted, and not weight bearing in our shop. Or a blend of all. So there are no pros and cons to what brand you wear. So it's, you know, the brand of footbed is just the manufacturing of the goods. It's the skill of the technician that actually makes them. So, I mean, I think a lot of guys use Instaprint or MasterFit. I personally use Cetus is my product. You know, a lot of people use Superfeet. Some guys use all their own materials. So, and then trim to fit and over the counter. I mean, it's better than nothing. You got to have something in there to stabilize the foot that has a heel cup that prevents over inversion and eversion of the foot. And then a medical orthotic would be great, except they don't fit. I think there used to be a guy in Vail that built beautiful medical orthotics that went into ski boots. There are plenty of podiatrists and podorthists that make them. And if you got them, use them. And there are some of the best athletes in the world that don't use them at all. There's not many of them, but there has been in the past. I'm running a little over time. So four and a half setup. So these are some columns here you know, we've all seen these people, C1, B1, A1, you know, A1 is kind of the ideal position you want to be in. That's that beautiful, the shoulders, you know, are over the hips, knees, you know, equal to or in front of the feet. You know, B1 is, you know, that person that has a very, not enough ramp angle or not enough forward lean in the boot. Then you have, you know, C1, someone that has excessive. You know, this is, you know, in an extended extension period, our stance. So, you know, with the ankle, when we talk about fore and aft setup, we're dealing with ramp angle and we're dealing with forward lean. So excessive forward lean affects dorsiflexion. Excessive or lack of ramp angle affects dorsiflexion. I'm not going to get into the physical adjustments of these things, but this is what you have to know, that if you're having problems dorsiflexing, you're having trouble firing those muscles to perform with the ski boot, this is where you have to start. They're in order for a reason. Looking at the hip is far forward. Now, that's a forward lean adjustment issue. If the hip's too far back, it can also be a ramp angle issue, and we need to adjust those things. Where are the shoulders in relationship to that? Are the shoulders back and the pelvis open? You know, that could be an issue with forward lean. It can also be an issue with ramp angle. So we always have to kind of look at this stance and address the setup to attack those ailments. Then we talk about lateral setup. So I'm just going to talk about the static version of it. So there's in lateral setup, we have Q angle is a term we use, bow-legged or positive stance, knock-kneed, straight leg, and then there's leg length discrepancies. So in the dynamic world, this is a little bit of like a movement analysis kind of a thing. This is some older information, but you know, a Q-angled skier, which is different than a knock-kneed skier, just to be clear, and I can get into that if I have 30. Yeah. So the difference between a Q-angled skier and a knock-kneed skier, it's literally a kind of like a genetic thing that where you know, the best way to describe it so that we can quickly grasp it is the knee joint is still looking forward, but yet there is the knees are converging. Okay. In the position of a knock-knee person, the knee joint is actually looking at each other. They're crossing if there were lasers on the front. And then obviously bow-legged, they're going out. All right. So that skier has a compact stance. Bow-legged, you know, a lot of chatter at the bottom of the turn, typically sits back a little bit because that tends to give them a little bit easier entry into the turn because they have so much leverage on that downhill ski. The skis tend to diverge because they can't lean on that downhill ski or it just kind of rips around. They have a little bit of a stranger stance with a little bit more standing up vertical spine, and they tend to bank a lot more. And then the knock-kneed skier, port edge hold, converging skis, body rotation, and unweighted downhill ski. And Angela, how are we doing, buddy?
I had a really good question about gear and movement analysis, kind of what you and I talked about earlier.
Yeah.
You're going to show that video, or do you want to touch on that now?
Which one?
Maybe it was a still image we were looking at earlier, and talking about how ski instructors can benefit from understanding this alignment information and doing movement analysis, like what to expect from somebody who's bow-legged versus knock-kneed, et cetera.
Oh, yeah. I mean, one of the just to I mean, in a movement analysis, yeah, I've got a bunch of photographs that we go through, but you know, one of the things I want to play here really quick, and I'm not going to bounce back and forth by the embedded video. I'm going to just play this, and I'll just take a second to load, but then I can talk over it. I know I'm coming close on time and everybody's attention. Okay. So, you know, when we're talking about setup and alignment, you know, it's really important that we take a look at what, Angela, is that coming through kind of clean?
Looks pretty good, yep.
Okay. I want you to take a look at this video and tell me if you would consider the skier in alignment. I know you know who it is. And we're just gonna watch right around this one gate here. Okay, so one of the topics that I bring up here is that, you know, what do you define, you know, as that, why I removed the idea of alignment. I mean, if I was if someone was to tell me that this person, a skier, has to have parallel leg shafts to be able to perform at the sport that they're performing at, and that's what we classify as alignment, I'd be like, holy smokes, I don't know. But it's more about ski performance and ski and performing the task, right? So you know, when we look at photographs, you know, again, stills are easier than video or someone skiing past you. But looking at, you know, there's a classic slightly underedge skier in the front. You can see that downhill ski drifting away, kind of leaning on that uphill ski because that's what's best for them to, that's the comfort zone. You know, in the back, we've got that, you know, the push off on the downhill ski and a little bit of that banking. You know, typically, you know, like an overedge position, more vertical spine. I use this as an example of a perfect, you know, look at the edge angles, the matching edge angles. But looking at the hips, the femur heads, the lower leg, tibia and fibula. I mean, that's a perfect setup. Overedged, you can see that the diverging ski, really leaning on that uphill ski because that downhill ski just wants to auger in. The banking. Here's an example of, you know, again, underedged, very well aligned, body stacked, you know, can lean and balance against the skis. I mean, that's what setup's all about. And I just love this picture because it like embodies skiing, the snow, the focus, the athleticism, just awesome. So for those of you that want to hang out and watch one more video, I'm going to play this. This is Lara Goot, ski technician or boot technicians. It's in German, so, but it kind of goes through what actually happens in this. Okay. All right, so that's kind of it. I mean, that's, I hope you guys kind of enjoyed that and kind of taking how, you know, using, and then just kind of, I guess, wrap that things up, you know, taking a look at the anatomy and the bones and the functions and the physiology of our lower leg, and how the boot is designed to allow those things to happen. That, I mean, that's what it's all about. And how we adjust those things, and it's not necessarily, I don't go through and explain exactly how we do adjust them. It really comes down to, you know, what adjustments there are to be done. You know, taking this on snow, I think is, and I think there's a lot of people that can attest to taking the on snow portion of this. It's a lot of information to cram into an hour and a half, especially when I can't have anyone to interact with except for my dog. There's so much more to it when we take it on snow and take those feelings of those lower leg muscles moving, and then making these adjustments to perform better dorsiflexion, inversion, and eversion. And that's, you know, I hope all you take away from this is understanding what those movements are, how they're performed with what muscle groups, and then being positive that the boot itself is engineered to perfection to allow you to do those things. And it's the boot fitters that perform the setup with you to then provide you with the setup. And it's a partnership. It's a relationship. There's plenty of great boot fitters, you know, I know of all over. Stratton, Vermont, Mount Snow, Stowe. I mean, there is just a lot of great boot fitters in, you know, Windham, New York, Hunter Mountain. I mean, and if you're from the West, I mean, Vail, Telluride, they're everywhere. And so building that relationship, having a little bit better knowledge and the ability to give appropriate and meaningful feedback as to what you're feeling, and having a better understanding of how the boot functions with our body. So, I mean, I've got a little bit of time. I don't know if anybody want to tell me what I do now.
Dave, we had a lot of really great questions, but there were a lot of them. I think a lot of folks would like that contact information that you said you'd provide.
Yeah.
I have two pretty general questions here that I think the broad audience might benefit from. Can you talk about life expectancy of a liner or a footbed for a minute?
Okay. Here come my pro salesman techniques here. My footbeds are like 9 years old. And as long as your foot doesn't change and they don't smell and they don't have some sort of stuff growing on them, I'd keep rolling with them. I can tell you that, you know, I know my reputation is that if you come in with anybody's footbeds, you know, we take a look and see what works before you make a bigger investment. If it isn't broke, don't fix it. Trust your boot fitter to give you the appropriate, hey, this isn't going to work, or did your foot change, or it's not supportive enough. You know, that's the determination. I I don't ski as much as I used to, but, you know, I'm out there 15, 20 days a year, maybe 30. I have no issue with still skiing in a 10-year-old footbed. Liners, I mean, in the environment, I would say a boot is supposed to last 100 days. You know, it's plastic. If people have heard me preach about this before, I mean, it's just like the Rubbermaid garbage can that you put outside. It's a little bit more involved with the plastic and the mixtures. It's not that generic. But, you know, the sun, the cooling and heating and cooling and heating and the sun, it deteriorates. So it loses its performance. So absolutely, I would say you should not ski a ski boot more than 150 days. And I'm sure that if there's boot fitters on this call would probably, you know, would agree with me. I mean, I feel like the first 50 days, you're just kind of like you're dating, right? You're just getting to know the boot. And then there's like the last 100 days are like the, or last, you know, like you got 75 days of just absolute pristine magnificence. And then the last 25 days, you're wondering what happened and where all the energy went.
Similarly, Dave, a couple of people asked how to take care of their boots.
Keep them buckled, keep them out of the sun. I mean, and don't put them in a super hot attic or a super moist place. I made that mistake and put my boots in my basement, which is just a little bit, you know, mildly moist or whatever. And I had like some sort of weird funk growing on the inside of them. So, you know, under the bed is like ideal, or in a closet. That's what I would recommend. Keep them buckled, take the liners out. You know, that would be my recommendation.
There were a handful of questions about your opinion on two-piece versus three-piece. Can you do like 30 seconds on that?
Yeah, two-piece. So two-piece overlap boots, I would say, are just, even though they're the, like the oldest version of the ski boots that we have, you know, when we look back at that lineage of ski boots that I had on the slide. But really, my opinion is that proximal flexing is in the modern ski boot. The offset hinges or ankle rivets, as you want to say, the slight offset in the cuff, the abduction of the slight abduction of the stance. The boot's designed to flex and invert and flex and evert. A three-piece shell, just by the sheer design of it, flexes fore and aft, like a hinge on a door. So it has its application. I don't particularly, if you're teaching skiing and you're learning how to ski by the standards and by the methods of the modern ski technique, I just don't. I mean, maybe there's been some changes between last year and this year, but I would say it's not as modern as the new designs of the two-piece overlaps.
Two more, if you have a minute. There was a question about, you know, your opinion of women-specific boots.
I'm sorry?
Women-specific boots. Recommend for all women, recommend for some women, et cetera.
It's all personal. I mean, you know, like there are, I don't know how to, like, there are, no, I would not say that there is any specific, because you're a woman doesn't mean, you know. So here's, I guess this is the only way I'm going to sum this up. Okay. Cause you gotta be like politically correct. Right. So there's such thing as female boots and there's unisex boots. There's no such thing as men's boots. So just take that. Okay, so all men's boots are designed and can be applied for female skiers. And I guess it would go both ways, you know, but I think 90 flex race boots have been like even 110 flex race boots, 120, 130. Race boots have been brilliant women's ski boots. So, I mean, that's a hard question to ask, but. Yes, I mean certainly start there, but it doesn't mean that because you're a female you can't ski in like a World Cup ski boot if you're capable of it. Does that answer the question? Maybe.
Yeah, I think so. One more, last one, and then anybody who did ask a question and it wasn't answered, I apologize. There are just a lot of questions coming in, and you can email Dave.
Well, hold on. Can I answer one? So yeah. Somebody asked me to talk about under-edged and over-edged. And I'm just, because I'm firing through these too. So under-edged, which I'm sure if I could have a show of hands, everybody would say, yes, I've heard somebody say that. So under-edged is meaning that the feet are slightly tipped to the inside, right? So there's no edge left to give, right? Everything is favored to the inside edges of the skis. So knock-kneed skier is under-ed. Meaning this is, let's say this is their downhill ski, right? And they're trying to edge this way. If everything is leveled in, fully everted or valgus or however many different terms you want to use. Okay, I try to keep it simple here. So that's why I, you know, you want to learn more, we can talk more. So there's no more to give. So that they have to do some sort of crazy body movement to get that downhill ski to hook up. And typically what an under-edge skier does is they lean on this uphill ski and this one drifts like this. And so, man, like the camera angle is so weird. So, you know, they lean on that ski, this one drifts away and they steer everything like that, okay? An over-edge skier, these are their feet, these are the boots, so they're bow-legged. They have all this movement to travel to get that downhill ski to hook up. So there's too much edge to give. The boots are tipped out, all right? So when they go, so they have all this leverage on the downhill ski and none on the uphill ski. So I hope that that's a decent enough explanation in terms of keeping it simple and understanding. So when we say you're bow-legged, you're positive, you have a positive stance because this is zero. We're adding numbers, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97. So that's over-edged. This is a knock-kneed skier, okay? So converging knees and femurs. So we're at 89, 88, 87, 86. So that's why we call it negative. So when I move a ski boot, and if any of my customers are here, I write -2, -1.5. It's because I'm moving it in a negative position. So it's the same thing. I'm making the boot under edge. I'm softening the edge. So if you're over edge, I'm taking material to bring the boot negative to soften the edge leverage. If you're under edge, I am adding edge to increase the edge leverage. I hope that that makes sense. Again, I try to keep this as simple as possible because, like, you know, when we work, you know, we work together with our boot fitters. So it's like, you know, you want to have the right question, but then also listen to their explanation too. Okay, next one. Go.
That's it. Why don't we provide the email? A lot of people are asking if it's been recorded, and this presentation is being recorded and will be available soon. But if you could provide your email now, I think that would.
Yeah. That so would, I'm good. And as long as that's all right with, you know, Don, I can, I'm going to send out this email. That's just a blanket email to everybody that, signed up for this and, you know, feel free to ask me questions or I can recommend a boot fitter that's local to you, or, you know, or anything like that. Happy to recommend, lots of good technicians out there. All right, so thanks everybody. I hope it wasn't too boring, and we can do this again. Let's, you know, when it's on the calendar to go and do this on the snow, sign up. It's a lot of fun.